Hola Merit, muchas gracias por compartir con nosotros este espacio. Para nosotros es un halago enorme que la directora o la jefa de neurología de un nosocomio tan prestigioso como el Massachusetts General Hospital esté dando este tiempo para poder ayudarnos a esclarecernos, a informarnos acerca del liderazgo que estás realizando en el mundo respecto a una posible y ojalá una cura para la ELA. Así que para nosotros es un enorme halago y una emoción muy grande contar contigo y para toda la comunidad afectada por la ELA en la Argentina. Muchísimas gracias por tu tiempo y muchísimas gracias por tu dedicación para poder hallar una cura a esta terrible enfermedad que nos afecta a todos nosotros como comunidad. Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you, first of all, for inviting me, and I wish I could be there in person with all of you. But I'm really honored to be here and to be able to share some really exciting new advances in ALS therapies that we all share the same goal is to find cures for people with ALS and to help everyone around the world with this illness and their family. So with that, let me see if I can go in slide mode. The really important thing is that there is progress and there's a lot to talk about. And there's really a global community that's working together to find treatments for people with ALS and to do it faster. So these are just a few of the groups that I work with. And we share that passion to speed the process up. So today I want to share some really exciting updates on some treatments that are in what I call late stage testing, so that they're the closest to going to becoming a marketed treatment for people with ALS. Talk a little bit about the pipeline of other great targets and therapies that are in development, and end with an update on the status of a new initiative that we started at the Healey Center and throughout the United States. To really speed up how treatments are developed in this platform trial approach. So just one slide or two on what we know about the biology of ALS. And this is important because it drives how we pick treatments to bring forward to our patients. So there's a lot of scientists all over the world studying ALS now. And every day there's papers out on new mechanisms. And we've learned a lot from people with ALS who participate in studies, both the people who have the genetic form and the people who have the non-genetic form. And what we've learned is that there's a lot of overlap in people with those two forms of illness. And it's telling us that there's problems with how proteins are made in the motor neurons, how they're folded, how that leads to problems with excitability, oxidative stress, energy metabolism, and inflammation. And those are all targets for treatment, both for familial and sporadic ALS. They've also given us lots of models of the disease, from fruit flies to mice to rats to cell-based models that let us screen drugs quickly before we bring them to the people so that we can pick the best ones to go forward. So this slide just shows some of the many, many trials going on in the world for people with ALS. The color code is really exciting because blue means these are treatments that have been tried in people with ALS in early trials that have some positive results. So that's an amazing number of treatments that have already some early phase positive data for people with ALS. In red are treatments that are in what we call the late stage, so in phase three testing, so that if those results are positive, they could be available quickly for people. And then there's over 100 things that are in the lab in companies that are getting ready to go to people. So I call that like pipeline pressure. There's so much going on that we have to think more creatively about how to do trials so that we can get through that pipeline and find the best ones. So of the ones in red, I'm going to show you some data on the Amylyx drug called AMX0035 and Neuren. But I'm happy to, in the Q&A, answer questions about these other drugs, which I know we have some questions on. So I want to just talk a little bit about how do we increase the chance of success when we do a trial. And the first step is always picking a drug that has good science and good rationale. And I think at this point, that's pretty much a given. Given that there's so many treatments out there, we only bringing forward to people the ones that have the best science. The other way to increase success is to design your trial in a way that gets a clear answer fastest and with the fewest number of participants so that you can eventually get that drug out there for everybody. And this has been done in two ways so far in ALS. One is called a cohort enrichment by finding people who are more similar to each other. So we know when we see people with ALS that there's huge variety in how the illness progresses, with some people with very slow course and others, unfortunately, with a faster course. Some people, it starts in the arm, some people in speech. There is what we call heterogeneity. And we don't understand all that biology, but if we take everybody in ALS trials, because of that heterogeneity, it's very hard to see if a drug works. You need hundreds, maybe thousands of people and to follow people a long time. So a couple companies have taken a different approach where they take people with early in the illness and who are progressing fast. And they do that so that in a 6-month period, they can tell if a drug works or not. So the three drugs that have used that approach are the edaravone, the AMX0035, and the Neurone study. Now, that doesn't mean it only works in that group. It's really a trial mechanism way to get an answer in a short amount of time in the fewest participants. Another way to cohort enrich is to go on biology. And obviously, this is always the better way, but sometimes it's not feasible because you don't have the tools yet to do this. So I'll give you some examples of that, particularly in the genetic forms. And lastly, I'll talk about how we can test more than one drug in the trial, so that at the end of the trial, we have an answer to several drugs and not one. So I think we all know the results of Radicava, so I'll be fast on this. But this is a marketed drug in many countries now. It came from Japan, and it's an intravenous antioxidant that was shown by MT Pharma to slow down the progression by about 33%. And this was on top of a baseline of riluzole. Everybody was on riluzole in the trial. In this study, they did several small studies, but one of them where they took a broader group of participants, they actually didn't see an effect when they looked at everybody. They only saw it when they looked at people early and who were fast progressing. And again, they don't think it's because it doesn't work in the other people, but it, more that it was hard to pick up a signal. So they repeated a study just in people who were within the first 18 months of their onset of their symptoms. They have widespread disease as a marker of fast progressing person. And in that cohort, they were able to see this big effect. And so that's and that was what led to the approval. And so there's really two possibilities. Either there's something different early in the illness, and it only works there, or this is a really good mechanism to screen drugs, the possibility too, and that it really works in everybody. And when the FDA, the US FDA, looked at all the data, they approved this for everyone because there was enough to support that this could work in everybody with ALS. So the AMX0035 study, also known as a combination of sodium phenylbutyrate and taurursodiol, it used a similar trial approach by enrolling people early in the illness with fast progression. And Dr. Paganoni was the senior author of that and works closely with me at Mass General Hospital. And we conducted this at 25 centers in the Northeast ALS Consortium. So what is AMX0035? It's a combination of two drugs. One is sodium phenylbutyrate, and that works by improving how a part of your cell called the endoplasmic reticulum works. That's a part of the cell that makes proteins. And we know in people with ALS that some of the proteins are made incorrectly and not fixed, and therefore aggregate in the motor neuron and cause cell death. So sodium phenylbutyrate works on that pathway, improves that function. The taurursodiol, also known as TURSO, works on the mitochondria, which are the part of the cells that make energy. And we know in people with ALS that the mitochondria stop working efficiently early in the illness. And the idea of the two founders of AMX0035 and Amylyx, their idea was adding these two drugs together would be better than taking either apart. And actually, as you probably read in the news, they came up with this idea as undergraduates at Brown University. And they contacted one of our investigators, Dr. Rudy Tanzi at Mass General Hospital, to ask if he liked their idea and could he advise them. And he gave them lots of great advice. They did a lot of preclinical work. I bumped into them really by chance and convinced them to work on ALS. And they did a lot of good preclinical data, and they came to our organization, NEALS, to help design the study. So this was a study that enrolled 137 people. Two-thirds of the people got the drug, the active drug, one-third got placebo. And those drugs were mixed together in a powder. And people were enrolled if their symptoms were less than 18 months from onset, breathing score more than 60%, and people could take riluzole or edaravone if they wanted. So the average age was 57 of the people in the study. They were about 13.5 months from their first symptom, 6 months from diagnosis, so early in the illness. About a quarter had bulbar onset and three quarters limb onset, and almost everybody was either on riluzole, edaravone, or both. And we saw a 2.32 difference in the score of this rating scale at 6 months. And so that's about a 25% difference between those on AMX0035 and placebo. So people on the AMX0035 did better than people who did not get it. And again, this was in the setting of people taking riluzole and Radicava. I think that's important. We also looked at other measures that are important for ALS. And on each of these, people did better on AMX0035 than placebo. That includes measures of strength, a tool called ATLAS, and as well as a measure of breathing, SVC. So everything was looking in the right direction for this drug for people with ALS. I might add that, though I don't show it here, we had good safety of this combination of drugs. There was some early issues with some nausea and GI upset, especially in the first 3 weeks, but over time, those improved. So I just showed you two examples of how if you take people early in their illness who have maybe more similar to each other, that you can get a readout in 6 months. Now, the Neurone phase 3 trial is doing almost the same thing. They're taking people early in the illness who are progressing at a rapid rate, and they're following them for 3 months. And then people are randomized 50% to getting the stem cell treatment, 50% placebo, and followed for 6 months. And then they're also followed another 3 months afterwards. And so those results are not available yet. They will be available probably at the end of 2020. At least that's what the company is saying. So I know there's a lot of interest in this, and I'll answer some questions in the Q&A. But this is a stem cell approach where we take people's stem cells from their bone marrow. Those are the cells that usually become your red or white cells. But here they're modified so that they secrete proteins that are good for motor neuron survival and are anti-inflammatory. And we think the primary mechanism of action of Neurone is as an anti-inflammatory approach. And in this phase 3 trial, the treatment is given every 8 weeks. And again, if you invite me back, we'll know the results towards the end of the year. So I want to shift to this other approach to get answers better or increase your chance of success. And that's by picking it based on biology. And the most obvious example is the genetic therapies for the people who have ALS from gene mutations. I'll just highlight a study that came out in the New England Journal of Medicine in July with a global consortium developing a new gene therapy for ALS caused by mutations in SOD1. And there's a lot of excitement about this. So here we know that the cause of the illness is the gene mutation, and we know that these antisense oligo gene therapy approaches can lower the amount of the mutated protein that's made. And so in this study, which was an early phase study, we enrolled 50 people with increasing doses of this antisense oligo called tofersen. And each group 3 people got the drug, 1 got placebo, but after the 12 weeks of treatment, everybody got the active treatment. And while this was an early safety study as the main outcome measure, we were also looking at, does it lower SOD1? Does it change anything clinically? And I'll just highlight that it definitely hit the target. It lowered the mutated protein, the regular protein, SOD1, by about 36%, which is what we were targeting. And it also lowered a marker of neuron axon damage called neurofilament. So that was good. It showed that it hit the target and was doing something biologically. And we also saw in every measure of clinical outcome that people on tofersen had a slower progression than people on placebo. And this was really obvious if you look at the bottom 3 curves in the group of people with the more aggressive mutations, the fast progressors, where we really didn't see very much change clinically, which is great, in the treated group. And we did see a progression in the people on placebo. And again, everybody in the study was then rolled over into open label extension where everybody's getting treated and we're still following those participants. And now there's a global phase 3 trial to go for confirmation of efficacy and long-term safety. And hopefully we'll know those results next year. And then I want to end talking a little bit about the platform trial. We're very excited about this approach. It's a new approach in ALS. This is the first platform trial in ALS, but it's not an old idea. It's been used in oncology trials for the last 10 years and has really sped up drug development there. And we wanted to bring that approach to ALS. This approach cuts the time to getting to effective treatments in half, cuts the cost by a third, and increases the chance of people getting active drug by 2/3. So there's no reason not to do this, especially when you have such a big pipeline. So what it means for people with ALS, if they come in the trial, they are randomized to any of the drugs that we're testing at that time. And right now we've started with 3 drugs. And then within the drug, let's say someone's randomized to regimen A, they are randomized 3-to-1 to drug versus placebo for 24 weeks. And then everybody can get open label drug afterwards for up to a year until we know the results of the study. And the advantage here and where you get all the savings is that we are combining the placebo groups in each of the arms. So we're sharing them. And that isn't done in traditional trials that are done one at a time. And so that's how you get more people on active drug. And you get, at the end of this trial, you get answers to 3 drugs, not 1. And actually it becomes a perpetual trial. As we get more and more good drugs, we just keep adding them to this platform. So we started in July. We're very excited about that at 54 centers throughout the United States. We do hope to go to other countries next year. We kind of started for simplicity in one country. The 3 first drugs are zilucoplan, verdipastat, and CNM-AU8. And they were picked by a committee based on looking for the best drugs out there based on the best science. So 2 of them work on inflammation, but in different ways. The zilucoplan blocks complement 5, verdipastat blocks myeloperoxidase, and then the last one, CNM-AU8, works on energy metabolism. And as I mentioned, there's 24 weeks on the double-blind period, and then there's an open-label extension for at least a year. I'm very excited to share that we are working with the 4th company, Prelenia, and we'll add pradopidine probably in November of 2020. And we're in discussions with 3 other companies to add them in 2021. For this, we have slightly broader criteria than perhaps what you saw in the Amylyx and the Radicava and the Neurone. So people can have the illness up to 3 years, vital capacity more than 50%. And ability to swallow, and people can take Radicava or Riluzole as long as they're on a stable dose. We're looking at measures of function, breathing, strength, survival, a lot of biomarkers. We're trying to actually learn not only that the drugs work or not, but learn about the illness so we can keep improving how trials are done. The COVID pandemic did delay us a little bit. We were hoping to start last March. But we do change the protocol to make it pandemic proof, meaning more home assessments, home visits, virtual visits in a way to make it easier for patients. And those are all good things for all future trials as well. So I want to end by saying that there's a lot of new things happening in ALS. There's new treatments. I really do think we're at the point where we're going to be having a lot of options for our patients. There's new ways to do trials better and faster, like the platform trial. And there's really an international effort to accelerate and share knowledge and find treatments and ultimately cures for people with ALS. So I work with so many people besides the patients that I love and the families that I get the privilege to take care of. I also have the privilege to work with an amazing group of collaborators through the Northeast ALS Consortium at our Healy Center and really around the world. So thank you again for inviting me here, and I look forward to answering your questions and being part of your community.
Merit, excellent. Very interesting, very exciting, for sure. These are the best times we ever lived in ALS research. Okay. That's, we have no doubt about that. So, okay, I have, thank you for that, of course. Bueno, entonces busco manos levantadas para los que quieran hacer preguntas primero sobre el tema de Neuron, el ensayo con células madres.
Mi nombre es Juan Sebastián Benítez. Soy de Cuartel Quinto Moreno y tengo 32 años. Hace un año y medio que estoy con esclerosis lateral amiotrófica. Me gustaría saber cómo es el tema para integrarme a la ¿cómo se llama? La medicación o al tratamiento del que están hablando. Yo lo único que estoy tomando ahora es Ilusol. Es lo que estoy tomando por el momento. Después no. Bueno, por el tema de la pandemia no puedo acceder a ningún sitio. Y bueno, quería saber qué puedo llegar a hacer para agilizar un poco la enfermedad, más que nada.
You know, the Neuron trial stopped enrolling last January, and they had finished enrolling 200 people. So right now there's no active trial enrolling. But we are going to have the results in the end of the year, and obviously if they're positive, the hope is that it will become a marketed treatment.
Bueno, muchas gracias antes que nada por este espacio, por todas las oportunidades, las posibilidades que nos da la Asociación en Argentina de poder participar de estas charlas tan valiosas para todos los pacientes, ¿no?, que tienen ELA y para familiares, y de poder hacer estas consultas que la verdad que son valiosísimas para nosotros. Y agradecerles una vez más, ¿no?, el gran esfuerzo que hacen digamos, en generar todo este material, ¿no? Ahí se nota que hay un gran esfuerzo de producción y un gran trabajo que realiza todo el equipo. Así que, bueno, muy agradecidos por eso, ¿no? Mi pregunta en relación a este tratamiento tiene que ver con el procedimiento, ¿no? En sí es un tratamiento que requiere de la extracción de células que se obtienen de la médula ósea del paciente, para que luego sean tratadas en un procedimiento que está patentado y a través del cual se convierten en células que en realidad producen altos niveles de factores neurotróficos para que finalmente sean introducidas nuevamente en la persona, ¿no?, a través de una inyección en el canal espinal. Entonces da la sensación de que se requiere de un procedimiento bastante complejo, ¿no?, para llevar toda esta situación adelante, y debe realizarse aparentemente en instalaciones que cuenten con una tecnología que permita realizar todo este tipo de abordaje. Entonces, sobre la hipótesis de que Neuron sea finalmente efectivo y logre aprobarse, la consulta es, ¿cómo tienen pensado llevar este tratamiento a todos los pacientes de ELA en el mundo, ¿no?
That's a really good question. I do think it'll be easier than delivering the future COVID vaccine to 7 billion people. So we can do it, I guess, is the main answer. You know, the technology to grow stem cells and the ability to have facilities to do that, I think is much better now than a couple of years ago. Again, driven by oncology, where they have these different stem cell treatments, but the same facilities for, you know, many more people than ALS. So I do think that we'll be able to give this globally using existing facilities that can grow people's stem cells sterilely. There'll be a lot of training of neurologists, but it's not a difficult treatment to give.
Como dijo Martín, gracias a la asociación porque Estos videos que ustedes hacen son súper útiles y la verdad que uno de los grandes problemas de la ELA es la información. Y bueno, para mí, estando acá, que hay muchísima información, son útiles, así que me imagino que para Argentina deben ser súper y para otros, sé que los ven en otros lugares del mundo, así que bueno, gracias. Mi nombre es Pablo Gatti, yo fui diagnosticado en mayo de 2019, justo cuando llegué a vivir a Estados Unidos. Me anoté en Neuron, viajé a San Francisco para hacer el screening, como le dicen acá, que es donde hacen todas las mediciones para ver si te aceptan o no en el trial. Y cuando iba a entrar, cuando iba a hacer el screening, me salió el test genético que era positivo para el SOD1, y bueno, entré, tuve la suerte de entrar en el trial de Tofersen. Lo que yo le quería preguntar a la doctora Kutkovitz es, más que una pregunta, es que supongo que lo va a hacer, es que explique un poco cómo es todo el procedimiento, que Martín habló un poquito de cómo es el procedimiento. ¿Cuántas, o sea, una vez que a uno le extraen las células de la médula ósea, cuánto tiempo pasa hasta que las procesan? ¿Cuántas, sé que se hace por punción lumbar, como dijo Martín, cuántas punciones lumbares recibe uno durante el tratamiento? Si es que hay alguna droga que hay que administrarla por vía oral o por otra vía durante el tratamiento. En fin, un poco cuál es el procedimiento del tratamiento, me gustaría mucho saberlo. Gracias.
That's a great question, and thank you for being part of the Tofersen trial. You helped a lot of people. It's so the process is that the first step is getting a bone marrow extraction. So the stem cells are in people's bone marrow, and that's taken from the hip, and that's done under anesthesia. And those cells are then transported to the facility that will grow them. And that takes about a month with a little variation. And that's done all sterilely and tested. And then we administer it into the spinal fluid. And that's done using the same approach what we do when we take spinal fluid as a test or someone gets anesthesia in the spinal fluid. So people are awake during it and a little local anesthesia, and we administer it that way. It doesn't take very long, and it's given every 8 weeks. So people don't stay overnight in the hospital. You might be in the center for an hour or two. And so that would be probably how it would be done if it became a marketed treatment. It would be done with the neurologist, with the collaboration with their experts in bone marrow extraction.
Mi papá es un TDLA diagnosticado hace 2 años y está en un estadio avanzado ya desde el 26 de agosto del año pasado, en el cual tiene internación domiciliaria, está con la tráqueo hecha, la gastro, y lo único que tiene es Riluzol, la medicación que tiene él ahora. Mi consulta con la doctora era respecto a si esta medicación serviría para el estadio en el cual se encuentra mi papá, este estadio que comentaba que es bastante avanzado, o si tal vez es para estadios más recientes de la enfermedad. Muchas gracias.
Yeah, that's a very good question, and I don't have the answer but I think it'll be important to learn. So sometimes these questions, like what you asked, are learned after a treatment goes on the market. So in the Neuron trial, we really only took people earlier in the illness. So we don't have any data on people like what you described for your father. But let's say it does work in the early people and comes on market. Often there will be like a study in later people, or people would try it in later people and write papers on it. So we would gather that information later. I just add, there's no biological reason that I know of that it wouldn't work in all people with ALS in all stages. You know, granted, if it works at all, it should work in everybody.
A fin de año, si llegara a aprobarse la fase 3 de este estudio clínico, lo que me gustaría saber es cuánto tiempo puede llegar a tardar, más allá del tratamiento, por eso las preguntas que hicieron los chicos es, ¿cuánto tiempo tarda por ahí la Federación de Estados Unidos en aprobar? Para tener una idea y uno pueda también calmar su ansiedad, saber de tiempos, ¿no? Y empezar a tener una idea de todo esto. Gracias.
Thank you for the question. I don't have a full answer. I can give you my guess at it. So the fastest I've seen a drug approved from the time that they knew the positive results approved into the market is 9 months. So it does take time because a company has to file all the data. It has to be reviewed. Often, though, if something is very positive, the company will provide an unexpanded access during that 9 month period or whatever that period is where it's under review. They'll set up a way to give it on a compassionate use basis so people don't have to wait.
Con respecto a esta droga en particular, el Neuron, quería saber si el ensayo está pensado para alguna forma de presentación, si por ejemplo para la presentación pseudo-vulvar es factible de que esta droga se use, o si sirve más para la forma de presentación de afectación de miembros, más que para la de pseudo-vulvar. Esa sería una pregunta. Y la otra pregunta también, sacando de lo que dijeron antes, es si también para esta droga, si también hay que tener el positivo en cuanto al componente genético, o si está pensada para cualquier paciente, por más que no esté positivo en el test genético. Gracias.
Yeah, it's a really good question. So, we'll know, maybe we'll know a little bit more when we see the data, because we could look at the differential effects in people with limb onset versus bulbar. We probably won't be able to answer the genetic versus non-genetic in this trial. But again, I think the mechanism of action is common to all those forms. It's really working as an anti-inflammatory drug. And we know that there's inflammation in sporadic ALS, familial ALS, bulbar onset, limb. So it really should work for all forms, if it works.
Pensar en una regeneración neuronal para los pacientes de ELA es algo muy esperanzador. Entonces, mi pregunta está relacionada con el mecanismo de acción de este tratamiento, que es bastante complejo. Si es que realmente regenera neuronas motoras, si lo hace a nivel de la corteza, si se cree que la neurona motora inferior también se regenera, si hay crecimiento de los axones en la médula espinal, un poco cómo es el mecanismo, o si simplemente la adición de estas células modificadas mejora la supervivencia de las neuronas motoras existentes.
I don't think that the neuron treatment will regenerate motor neurons or cause the axons to grow. So they're really using these stem cells as a delivery mechanism to deliver like nerve growth factors or proteins that can promote motor neurons to survive and decrease inflammation. And also the stem cells don't last. And that's the reason why it has to be given every 8 weeks. Those cells are eventually cleared by your body, but what they secrete might last longer. But it's really not a regenerative treatment. Now, that doesn't mean that it's not important to work on regenerative treatment. I think we all want that. And there are certainly companies and working on ways to regrow axons and repair.
Perfecto. Si no tenemos otra pregunta relacionada con Neuron, con esta droga en particular, vamos a pasar al siguiente tema de la tarde de hoy, que dijimos que tiene que ver con una nueva esperanza que hay en la ELA, que tiene que ver con la droga AMX0035.
He tenido la oportunidad de leer el artículo que salió a través de la página ALS, y también tuve la oportunidad de inscribirme como peticionante para que salga rápido la droga para el FDA, porque creo que de todo lo que he leído y lo que tenemos dando vuelta, en lo personal me pareció muy esperanzador porque bueno, y aquí por ahí empiezan a aparecer las preguntas. Creo que es para todo tipo de ELA, con lo cual sería una pregunta para la doctora. Creo que también es, me parece, y sería la segunda consulta, es de lo menos invasivo. Y por otra parte, que lo que me entusiasmó, como que hay una posibilidad de recuperarse, como que te regenerás en algún aspecto.
Great questions. And I do think if gets approved, I think it would be for all forms of ALS. In the trial, it was for all forms. There was no restriction other than looking for people early in the illness. The mechanism of action is really about preventing cell death. And if you prevent cell death, which is important, in theory, your motor neurons can regenerate. We know that neurons have the ability to regenerate on their own and regrow. And we know in ALS that your body is trying to actually regenerate when we do the EMG studies, but it can't keep up with the damage of that's happening in the motor neurons. So in theory, if you can slow down that damage and prevent the motor neuron cell death pathway, your body's own ability to regenerate could kick in. But these drugs themselves they're not working on the regeneration pathway, but they're blocking the cell death that is inhibiting the regeneration, if that makes sense. So in a way, any drug that really works in ALS and slows down the progression should help promote your own body's way of regenerating your axon.
Lo que entendí y leí dos drogas, ¿no? Que se pueden tomar conjuntamente con el riluzol y el edaravone. Si esas dos drogas actúan, si no hay efectos colaterales con las otras dos, se actúa en conjunto, se potencian, digamos, tipo cóctel.
Yeah, really good question, and we don't know. I mean, this trial wasn't designed to answer that question, but to answer that question, we would have needed to have everybody on riluzole and edaravone, and then the only difference between the two groups being the AMX0035. Now, we almost had that. About 77% were on it, and in that setting, we did see this additional 25%. So clinically, if this becomes available, I would treat my patients with all the three drugs and view it as a cocktail. But I can't say that we completely have that supporting data from this one small drug study.
Bueno, mi pregunta tiene que ver con en relación, bueno, a este fármaco producido por Emilix, ¿no? Que ha demostrado tener una tasa de enlentecer, ¿no? La progresión de la ELA. Quería consultar en relación al acceso, ¿no? A poder formar parte de esto. En realidad, teniendo en cuenta que estamos en una zona geográfica un poquito complicada, ¿no? Al momento de tratar de formar parte de ensayos clínicos, quería consultar en relación al petitorio, ¿no? que está circulando, en el que se solicita la aprobación urgente de este fármaco. ¿Qué implicaría poder lograr el acceso ampliado al medicamento hasta que se pueda completar la fase 3 y pueda ser comercializado? ¿Esto posibilitaría lograr el acceso a este fármaco por parte de toda la comunidad de ELA, independientemente del país en donde uno se encuentre? Y de no ser así, ¿cuáles serían los criterios, ¿no? que se utilizarían para determinar quiénes podrían tener acceso a este tratamiento?
So, those are really great questions. We're in a new world. I mean, it used to be that we would never think that a drug based on this one study, which was relatively small, 137 people, 6 months, would get approved. But I think that because a lot of patient advocacy and the seriousness of this illness, that things have changed in the regulatory arena. You know, for example, edaravone was approved on 6 months. So I am hopeful. I think that those discussions have to happen between the company and the regulatory agencies about what the step forward is. Could it be approved with a condition on a future phase 3 trial? That's done a lot in oncology. Not done that much in neurology, but maybe it's time for that to change. And in which case, then it could be something that could become globally available. But I know the company is talking to the regulatory agencies in Europe and in the U.S. and hopefully in South America and different countries to try to work out that pathway.
Yo le quería preguntar a la doctora acerca del origen de las dos drogas del AMX0035. Por lo que tengo entendido, uno de los componentes, una de las drogas, ya está aprobada por la FDA. ¿Eso es cierto? Gracias.
Yeah, they're both what I would call repurposed drugs. One is actually a supplement. The Torso is a supplement that people used to use for who had gallstones. It's a bile acid drug. So it's an old supplement. So that is kind of, in a way, on the market. The other drug, sodium phenylbutyrate, is an FDA approved drug for a childhood illness called urea cycle disorder. So it's a very rare disease in children, and it's on the market for that. So sometimes you can really speed up drug development, like in this case, when you repurpose existing drugs, because then you don't have to do all the the safety studies that they've already been done. You can leap right into patients much faster, which is what they were able to do. And the origin really was from these two amazing young men who came up with the idea in college when they were thinking about cell death pathways and were there drugs out there already that might target them. And in a way, the Torso and sodium phenylbutyrate were already in small ALS studies. I had done one in, about a decade ago looking at the dose of it, and there was a lot of interest in these two drugs already. They just combined them and they did the additional work needed to get them to patients.
Lo que quería saber es cómo hay que hacer para entrar a un ensayo clínico. ¿Cómo qué es lo que hay que hacer para poder entrar?
Sea de este o de cualquier otro estudio clínico vigente. Yo estuve leyendo que generalmente los estudios clínicos no te dicen que no tenés que tomar Riluzol o Edaravone, sin embargo este estudio clínico sí permite la combinación, si no entendí mal, ¿no, Pablo? Entonces, ¿por qué sería el caso de que este estudio clínico permite no suspender la toma de Riluzol o Edaravone y los demás no?
Yeah, good question. So the trial is finished, this one. So it finished enrolling, it finished the follow-up. So there isn't an active trial yet of AMX0035 right now, mainly because they're trying to decide the regulatory pathway. Do they need another trial or do they have enough for approval for marketing? And once they know that, then we'll know whether there's going to be another trial or not. The there was so much patient advocacy, which is really very positive, that the FDA wrote, with the help of patients and clinicians like myself, a guidance document for future ALS trials. And one of the key points they put in there is that no trial should disallow standard of care, unless there was a safety reason for that. And so you will see, I hope, that all trials allow Riluzol and Edaravone going forward. I know in the past, especially like, for example, Neurone did not allow Edaravone. But I think that's not going to be possible anymore. And it shouldn't be. I mean, people should be able to have standard of care. So the platform trial allows both, and most studies do now.
Pasemos entonces al siguiente tema, que tenía que ver con la plataforma Healy. Healy se llama el centro de ELA, donde trabaja la doctora Merit Kutkowicz, que está en Massachusetts.
Soy de Puerto Madryn, tengo 52 años y hace un año que fui diagnosticado con ELA, síntomas tengo desde hace 2 años. Y respecto de esta plataforma Healy, quería preguntar si se hace una combinación de medicamentos, ¿cómo saben en el paciente cuál es el que le hizo efecto y cuál no? ¿Cómo pueden distinguir cuál es el que le hizo efecto y si le hace efecto?
A really good question. So in the platform trial, each drug is given separately. So a person in the platform trial receives one drug. They don't receive all three. Now, so we'll be able to tell each one at the end whether they worked or not. Now, if one of them works, we can then add it as a baseline to all the other ones. That's the beauty of the platform trial. You can adapt it as you learn information, so that eventually we would be having people on cocktails of everything that's positive.
Yo le quería preguntar a la doctora en más o menos en cuántos centros en Estados Unidos se está usando esta plataforma y si en todos los centros que se aprueben y se usen, se van a usar la misma cantidad de drogas. Por ejemplo, en Fort Lauderdale, donde yo me atiendo en el Instituto de Neurociencias de Fort Lauderdale, a cargo del doctor Locatelli, este año todavía no empezaron, sé que ellos van a ingresar, yo no sé si esto es por el COVID o por otras razones, pero bueno, quería saber en qué centros ya se está usando y cómo es un poquito el plan para poder ingresar a este tratamiento experimental.
So we're starting with 54 sites. We are going to probably add more. Each site offers everything that's open in the platform trial. So right now we have 3 drugs that we're testing. Every site offers all 3. And that's actually really important for the success of the platform because we're, again, pooling the placebo data from those each of those arms. And so we need everything to be the same. Otherwise, you could get variations in that placebo group and you can't pool them. So we only take sites that are willing to do all the arms, but we also pick all the best drugs. There's no bad drugs in the platform.
Aprovecho que estamos todos acá. Yo recibí un mail de ALS News Today hace un par de días que habla del Ibudilast. ¿Escuchaste nombrar algo vos sobre eso? Dice que es que esta droga se aprobó ahora para el uso en Canadá y que acá en Estados Unidos todavía la FDA no la aprobó.
Yeah, so Ibudilast actually isn't approved in the terms of marketing in Canada or in the US. It is approved in Japan for a different indication. It's approved for people with I think stroke as an acute treatment. It's in trials in Canada, in the US, and elsewhere. And they're just starting a phase 3 trial. And maybe what you read was that they got approved already to go forward in Canada for that trial. But it's not a marketed drug there for ALS. We actually don't know if it works. The phase 3 trial will tell us whether it's an effective treatment or not.
Mi pregunta es, frente a todas estas noticias, ¿sí? Estas novedades, sobre el adelanto, ¿no? de métodos, de, digamos, como para curar la enfermedad o mejorar el estadio, es si también se ha avanzado en la búsqueda de cuál es el origen que genera, cuáles son los factores que afectan, si hay una cuestión genética, ¿no? Que pasa en el caso de nosotros, los hijos. Nosotros somos dos hermanas.
That's a really good question, and we need a lot more research on that. But there was a paper by Dr. Amar Ashlabi, which was really helpful in understanding this. ALS is for sure a multifactorial disease, meaning there's many causes in an individual person. And so his study suggested that there's 5 or 6 things that happen to one in your lifetime that lead to ALS. And you only really get ALS if all those things happen. And those 5 things might be different between different people. So that makes it really complicated to figure out in an individual person what their cause is. We know if you carry a gene, that kind of accounts for 3 or 4 of those risk factors, but you still need something else that will explain perhaps why in a family some people get it when they're 80, some when they're 40, some never get it. But people who don't carry a gene, it's really 5 environmental things. And we know that smoking increases your risk, age, you know, which we can't control age, but age increases your risk. It's more common in soccer players as well as American football. So there are these risks, but they're all small. There's no big one like the risk of smoking and lung cancer. There's nothing like that people have found. We need to keep working on that so we can work on prevention.
So Merit, taking this chance that we still have a couple of minutes more, I was going to ask you, Emilix looks really promising and many people weren't seeing that coming. So do you think we can expect Emilix to be a little bit of an upgrade compared to Riluzole or Anadarvon? Or is it too early to say that?
I it's hard to compare all these drugs, right? Because we didn't compare them one at a time. But I think it's not going to be either or. I think it's going to be like added on to it, right? And then we're going to be treating people with cocktails of drugs to really get a big impact. I mean, the Derivone was done really as an add-on study, so we know that Derivone adds to Riluzole, because everybody was on Riluzole in the trial, and then you either got a Derivone or not. So if you had were on both, you had an additional 33%. We didn't quite do the study that way for Amylyx, but I think clinically it's going to be something we add on to it rather than exchange for one. And if you think of some like serious cancers, they're treated by 4 or 5 cocktails of drugs. So each one does a small amount, but when you take all of them, you get really meaningful, big effects. And I think that's going to happen in ALS as well.
It really looks like it's going to be a cocktail of drugs. Probably the key to success in the future. Yeah. Is that correct?
For sporadic disease. You could see that for familial ALS, depending on the results of the gene therapies, maybe it really will be one treatment, the gene therapy.
Muchas gracias, Merit, por tu invalorable explicación y las aclaraciones respecto a nuestras dudas y nuestras inquietudes acá en Argentina. Valoramos muchísimo este tiempo que nos has dado. Para nosotros es un enorme halago que una prestigiosa investigadora del mundo, una neurocientífica como vos, esté dándonos esta oportunidad. Te agradezco mucho y espero, luego del paso de este COVID-19, podamos volver a reencontrarnos personalmente como nos pasó en Perth el año pasado. Así que un gran saludo y muchísimas gracias nuevamente en nombre de toda la comunidad afectada por la ELA en Argentina y de habla hispana que va a recibir este material valiosísimo para poder seguir informados respecto a una posible cura y lo que es la actualidad de investigación en el mundo. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, I'm sure you will. Appreciate it. Great to see all of you. See you soon, hopefully.
Thank you so much. Take care. Bye. Gracias. Muchas gracias nuevamente. Les agradecemos a todos por participar. Gracias. Cuídense, ¿sí? Sigamos cuidándonos. Gracias. Hasta luego. Hasta la próxima.